Hey, this that Eastside Johnny Big Redemption, like, know what I'm talking about? Hold up.
Whoa. All right, welcome back to The Rivalry. I am your host, Sean, along with my brother, Mike. And today we are going to be doing a post-game analysis of the Browns versus Eagles matchup, which was at 1 o'clock at First Energy Stadium. We were not able to do a pregame analysis. My apologies, because we did not have enough time to do it. All right, so starting off, I don't think any of us were surprised at the outcome of the game. I knew the Browns were going to win. Did I think they would have won by more? Yes, but the weather was bad, and most of it was just the Eagles getting garbage yards half the time. So, all right, first topic is, which was a bigger factor in the win, the Browns' offense or the defense?
The Browns' defense. It wasn't even close. We knew the Browns' offense eventually would get started, and obviously the run game is the key to the Browns' offense, and as the game wore on, the Browns just started eating up yards. Like they were saying, I think they were, 20 yards at halftime? Or not even. Kareem Hunt had negative yards till about 2 minutes left in the fourth quarter.
Mm-hmm.
He actually had a touchdown before he had any positive yards. So, I would say it's a defense. It seemed like they were saying, when we needed the defense to step up, they did, and they kept coming up with key stops. And I think we played very well. I think offensively, we definitely could have been better, but we played good enough. We played good enough to win, and that's really all I care about.
And I think it was actually making a statement showing, hey, we may not have Myles Garrett, who, in my opinion, is the defensive player of the year, even though I'm a Steelers fan. He will win it, but they were just showing, hey, we may not have him, but we could still make plays. Yep. Denzel Ward, Adrian Claiborne, Olivier Vernon, who honestly hasn't really done that much up until like
this was his best game by far as a Brown.
I don't remember game. He had another big game. I don't remember what team it was against, but that's
but nothing of that stature. He filled in for Myles Garrett, and honestly, Myles might have had more stats.
Oh, he would have had like 4 sacks.
But still, he had a great effort, and I was very surprised.
I think it does show how valuable he actually is, because although his statistical standpoint isn't insanely big, it is the fact that Myles Garrett does consume like 95% of those entire sacks.
Yep. Now, for the next topic, what does this mean for Carson Wentz?
I think he's trash, and Jalen Hurts should start. People keep saying, oh, Carson Wentz has nothing. He's had nothing for every single season he's been there. You could even look at it. He's had absolutely nothing. Yeah, he doesn't have Lane Johnson. That's a whole different story. But he's done something with nothing when he went 13-3, got his ACL torn against the Rams, and since then he just hasn't done jack. And I don't think it's fair for everyone to keep continuing to make excuses for him. Because if this was Baker, if Baker was in that exact same situation, people would say, oh, he's washed, he's garbage, cut him, he's done. But I think Jalen Hurts needs the opportunity because, I mean, he's mobile, so he's way more mobile than Carson Wentz, so he's going to be able to get out of the pocket. He doesn't hold the ball for 5 years, and that's why Carson Wentz also gets sacked so much. And it's like, I think he got sacked like almost 40 times total this season, which is the most in his entire career.
I would say I agree. I honestly don't think he's as trash as people think he is. Because if you look at some of the interceptions, it's really not all his fault. Now, he did not play good, and he hasn't been playing good. But I do think he has not gotten any help from his franchise. But he still has to play good because he's the quarterback. So no matter what, if you're going to hold someone to that standard, you got to hold him to the same. Honestly, I think it's also mainly because of the money he got. If he didn't get the money he got, I don't think people would be as upset. No, and I think they would have turned it over to Jalen Hurts earlier. And I think Jalen Hurts, he should start. I just don't know if you want to start it now or you want to wait till next year. It's kind of hard. He's got to still learn the offense, and he's only played so many snaps.
No, Carson Wentz also should have known I shouldn't have taken that much money because, one, the expectations were going to be really high, and number two...
That's not his fault, though.
Yes, it is. If he didn't take that much money, they could have also spent more money on free agents, would be able to help him in the long run.
But
there are problems with their offensive line, with their defense, with their wide receiver.
But when you're an NFL player, you take the money as you get it.
Yeah, well, that's his fault.
He might not care.
Why do you think Russell Wilson also doesn't have a bunch of help on defense? You know how much money he took up in cap space? That's going to come back to also bite Patrick Mahomes right in the ass.
Not the way they worked the contract.
$500 million over 10 years.
Not the way they worked the contract.
Unless Tyreek Hill and Travis Kelce are going to be able to take a pay cut, he's not going to have them for much longer either. All right, now can the Browns hold this playoff spot? Because Ravens lost in overtime with the Derrick Henry 29-yard touchdown run in overtime, and also including that AJ Brown had a beast mode receiving touchdown, which also helped them go in overtime. But I think they will be able to hold this playoff spot. I do have to look at the schedules of each team because I think schedule does matter in this factor if they hold the playoff spot. I think they will. I think they will beat Baltimore the next time they face them. Steelers, in my opinion, I think the reason they will beat the Steelers in Week 17 is because Steelers are 10-0. I don't see them really losing that many games this season because they don't have any really harder games on their schedule, and they're probably going to rest their starters that last game.
I agree. While you're looking up the schedule, I also don't know the schedule. My guess would be the Browns probably have the quote-unquote easier schedule, minus Baltimore and the Steelers, but I don't know. See, with the Ravens, like, how do you really say they have a hard schedule when they really were in the top of the league? In my opinion, I think they will hold the playoff spot. I just think the Browns are in a really good place right now. Had a couple sloppy games, and that's really sometimes will be a playoff game because, you know, not everything's perfect when you, you know, when you're in the playoffs, you're not every game is going to be 70 degrees, no rain, no nothing. You know, playing in Cleveland, that's an advantage for us, and I like having that advantage.
And we actually, before I discuss any more into the playoff spot topic, we actually just got a notification that rookie QB for the Bengals, Joe Burrow, has suffered a torn ACL, which is obviously a giant-ass hit to their team because they have Ryan Finley, who obviously no one knows as their backup, and I don't think they're going to win another game for the rest of the season. But let's get back to the playoff spot.
Let me say something about that real quick. Yeah, obviously that's a huge loss. That's basically the Bengals team. And although I don't like the Bengals, Joe Burrow was really surprising me. I thought he was just all hype coming out of college, but he really showed that he's going to be a good player in this league for a really long time.
All right, so I brought up the Ravens' schedule. I think they have a Thursday night game coming up next against the Steelers. I think that's a loss, so they'll end up 6-5, beat the Cowboys 7-5, lose to the Browns 7-6, then beat the Jaguars 8-6, Giants 9-6, and then the Bengals 10-6 is what I think their ending up record will be. Browns are going to beat the Jaguars. I think it'll be a really close win versus the Titans, so they'll be 9-3. Yeah, I already talked about the Ravens, so they'll be 10-3. Gonna beat the Giants, gonna beat the Jets and Steelers. So I'm predicting that the Browns will end up with a 13-3 record with a second.
If the Browns go 13-3, we're going to the Super Bowl.
No, I think I think the Browns. If
we could go 13-3, we're gonna win the Super Bowl.
They don't really have, other than Tennessee and Ravens, I don't really see any teams more of a potential loss threat to them. Because Steelers are obviously gonna rest their starters last game if they continue to play at the way they are. So the Browns, I think, will end up with a 13-3 record, which is sad because it'll show, like, in history that they were second place in their division. But it's the AFC North. I mean, they were third place. They were 7-3. Well, 6-3, and they could have been first place in almost every other division. Now, what can the Browns do better moving forward? I think their defense is going to continue to improve as it has the past few games. I do think they do have to learn how to be a four-quarter team. Other than the Cowboys game, I don't think they've ever really had a game where they've been consistently dominating for four quarters, to tell you the truth.
I agree. I think, honestly, the third quarter is our worst quarter. We've been up in games. It feels like the past couple games we've been up. And going into halftime, you're feeling really good. It's like, okay, it's a one-score or a two-score game. And then third quarter, I mean, you just find a way not to put points on the board.
Yeah, they only had five.
Yeah, and that was because of a safety and a field goal, granted. But it's like you don't put any points. And honestly, although that is very annoying as a Browns fan, we've done a good job in closing out games, which is really what's opened my eyes, at least throughout the season, is our ability to close out games, whether the team's good or not. The bottom line is that we're finding a way to close out the game and win it. So
I do think that the one thing that they always is always going to be sort of a problem is their safeties. I think they're going to have to get a bigger safety in free agency this coming up season, because they, I mean, Andrew Sandejo, he didn't give up a deep ball this game, but he does tend to do it in big games. And I think, speaking of the full four-quarter game, playing hard, dominating, that's going to be their biggest key when they also face the Titans and the Ravens, which are two very, very dominant teams. I mean, I know the Browns' record is better than the Ravens, but you obviously have to understand that the Ravens do have one of the best rushing attacks in the NFL.
Yep. And now we're going to go to Kareem Hunt and Nick Chubb. Obviously, Kareem Hunt didn't have a very good game running, or at least statistically, but if you watched it in the fourth quarter, he really turned it up. Nick Chubb broke the game loose in the fourth quarter. So with that being said, do you think this is one of the best running back duos that's ever played in the NFL?
Easily. I guarantee they are both going to be 1,000-yard rushers. And it's different when a quarterback and a running back are 1,000-yard rushers rather to a running back. I think it's harder for a running back and a running back to get 1,000-yard rushing opportunities due to the fact that the quarterback is always going to be on the field unless they get injured, or there's some like play like how Jalen Hurts is with the Eagles or Taysom Hill is with the Saints. I think it's easier when you're a mobile quarterback to get 1,000 yards rushing and have your running back do that. It's more impressive because not only do the Browns have two great running backs in Kareem Hunt and Nick Chubb was also the second leading rusher last year, almost a rushing champ. Kareem Hunt was already a leading rusher right at the Kansas City Chiefs, as we all know. And they also have an excellent running back and coach in Stump Mitchell, who I believe is like probably one of very few Browns staff coaches that have been on the team for the past 3 or 4 years that's been staying. He's like one of the most consistent coaches.
Yep. Honestly, I don't know too much about duos and whatnot. I know during the game they were showing running back duos who have run for 1,000 yards plus, and there was...
They also showed quarterback and running back.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, best duos are duos that have run for 1,000 plus. And the Browns have done it once, and I believe they can do it again. If you look at it, Nick Chubb is about at 600 yards, and Kareem Hunt is over 600 yards.
Oh, yeah.
We're at the, Nick Chubb has missed, four?
He's missed, three or four games.
Three or four games?
And he also has probably, I think Kareem Hunt had, before, when they showed that stat line, so I don't know how much the stat line changed after the game, but Nick Chubb had 94 carries for almost as many yards as Kareem Hunt, who had 143 carries.
Yeah. And so, with that being said, I do think that they could reach a 1,000-yard mark. If they do, that'll be a really cool thing to see. And if they don't, they don't. It's not like, they have to rush for 1,000 yards or not. They're not one of the best duos ever. Because if you really look at it, once we get the run game going, it's basically over. If we could run against you, it's basically over, because you can control the ball game and the tempo all game long if you're able to run the ball.
And you also realize that Nick Chubb and Kareem Hunt don't really care about stats as long as they win. I mean, Nick Chubb literally
prevented
himself from scoring a touchdown last game versus the Texans because he doesn't give a damn about what fantasy people want. It's about the team winning, which I think is actually very important. Not to also mention his beast mode run where he stiff-armed, I believe, the linebacker Singleton to the ground.
It was like a D-tackle that looked like him.
Oh, yeah,
but he made him look like a little child out there.
And also, not to mention that hit where Dallas Goedert thought he was good for trucking Denzel Ward, who's 5'11", and Mac Wilson came up and just smacked his ass.
Yeah, that's what he gets. You try to bully a guy who's a third of your size and the game's already over trying to truck him, and then you get lit up. That's what you get.
And we also haven't mentioned Sione Takitaki's big game, which I think he hasn't really been that great in his years playing. I believe this is his first year starting. He only plays 40% of the defensive snaps, but today he really did improve. And Denzel Ward did smack Carson Wentz, causing him to throw such a bad ball for Takitaki to pick, but he was really all over the field for most of the game.
Yeah, at least as far as the first half. I mean, not even including the interception, because that could really be anybody. I mean, it was a great heads-up play by him, but he was in the right place and he made the play. Early in the game, it felt like he was really He was really just flying all over the field, and he was very active. So it seemed like he, with Myles Garrett being out, he was kind of one of the leaders on the defense, at least, for the first half. It looked like his play set an example, you know, and it kind of rallied the troops together.
I do think, not that it's a good thing that Myles Garrett was out, obviously. No one wants someone to be out due to a terrible virus or an injury, but I think one of the best benefits about him being out is it shows that you can also substitute Adrian Claiborne and Porter Gustin whenever you want, because they're not like insanely great players, but they will hustle to the ball every single play.
Yeah, honestly, as a Browns fan, it felt good just to see us win without him, because if you think about it, I mean, you never really know what you have until someone's gone. And to be honest with you, the game against the Raiders, we just looked flat defensively, and I think the Browns players knew that, and they were sick and tired of hearing that, you know, the Browns defense is in this and this without Myles Garrett. So really it was kind of a motivating game for us. All right, thank you guys for listening to the podcast. Next week, obviously, we'll be covering the Browns game, and stay tuned for any other coverage of the Browns game, and we're possibly thinking about just covering the playoffs. Other teams once it starts to get in the thick of things. And be sure to subscribe to the channel, like the video, and stay tuned for any podcasts coming up in the future. Thanks for watching and have a good day. Catch me on the scene of, catch me on the scene of, catch me on the scene of, that's the only